All right. Hey, everyone. Thank you so much for coming here tonight. We're so excited. This was such a great turnout. We'll start right away. Our first speaker is Mark Cho from our Flink platform team.
All right. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Mark, and I work on the Flink platform team here at Netflix. And my talk today will be on our self-service Flink platform that we built over the last couple of years to create leverage for all of our Flink users at Netflix. Let's get started. At Netflix, Flink is the paved path solution for building a stream processing application for data analytics. As of today, we have over 2,500 Flink jobs running in production as part of our Keystone Router offering. And we have over 150 custom Flink jobs developed and operated by our other teams. All of these jobs have vastly different characteristics. Some of our massive throughput jobs have very high parallelism, running at over 2,500. And some jobs require large amount of state. While other jobs have very complicated logic, some of which involve joining over 10 Kafka topics in a single job. To manage all of these jobs, we needed to build a self-service platform that other teams could leverage to develop and operate their Flink jobs. We call this the Stream Processing as a Service platform, or simply SPAS platform. One of the goals was to abstract away common logic and code that all Flink jobs required to run in our Netflix ecosystem. These include integration with Newt to generate scaffolding needed to start developing a Flink job, with runtime platform for things like service discovery, dependency injection, and fast properties, and with Spectator and Atlas, which is our metrics platform. As part of SPAS, we also offer out-of-the-box config-driven sources and syncs with support for Kafka, Keystone, Elasticsearch, Hive, and Iceberg. And finally, the SPAS control plane ties all of this together and allow users to configure, deploy, and manage their jobs. Let's start with new user onboarding and development experience. We provide the Flink integration with Netflix Newt tool, which generates the necessary scaffolding. Here's a quick GIF on how the tool works. Flink Newt sets up tools like Git repository in Bitbucket, Rocket CI jobs in Jenkins, and creates a Spinnaker application. It also generates a ready-to-run and deploy Hello World Flink job in Java or Scala. The Hello World Flink job that we generate looks something like this. It's a very simple job to read a live Kafka topic, Kafka source, and write to null sync, which is standard out. Users can modify the DAG by adding different sources and syncs to quickly experiment and ramp up on Flink. This job can run locally or it can be deployed in the cloud using the SPAS control plane. The generated project also includes default configurations for our config-driven sources and syncs. Implementations for common sources and syncs are provided by the platform. And users only need to specify basic configuration to build a source or a sync with a single line of code. And as of today, we have out-of-the-box support for Kafka, Keystone, Elasticsearch, Hive, and Iceberg tables. Gradle is the officially supported build tool at Netflix, and we built the custom Gradle plugin, which manages the build logic for our Flink job. As part of the build process, we create and register a Docker image for each Flink job so that we can run the job in a containerized environment. The plugin also extracts Flink and application configurations from the job and registers a job with their control plane. And these build can run locally or on a Jenkins job, which is set up perf link job by our Newt generator. Next up, let's talk about deployment management. Using Spinnaker, we deploy Flink jobs on top of Titus, which is the Netflix container management platform. The control plane orchestrates each Flink job as a separate Flink cluster to provide isolation. For each job, we create an autoscaling group with a single job manager container and another autoscaling group with many task managers. Multiple Flink jobs share a ZooKeeper cluster and S3 bucket, but we provide isolation in ZooKeeper per job and per deployment. We also leverage Flink's entropy injection feature to achieve high scalability on an S3 bucket. The SPAS control plane is a central place where the users can configure, deploy, and operate their Flink jobs. Users can set or override any configuration, including Flink configs, application configs, and manage sources and syncs. Here, they can also dynamically change the job DAG, such as changing the sources or syncs without having to rebuild their job. And through a custom Gradle build plugin, we're able to capture additional metadata about the job image at build time. These additional metadata include Flink version, author, Jenkins link, repository, and branch of the job, repository and branch of the job code. When it comes to deploying the Flink job, the control plane orchestrates the creation of a new Flink cluster per job and per deployment. Users can specify different deployment modes in regards to state. For example, one of them is deploying a new job with an empty state, deploying a job with existing external checkpoints, and deploying a job with a save point. Let's talk about operational tooling for our Flink jobs. Netflix Flink integrates with Spectator Metrics Collector to publish all metrics from a Flink job to Atlas. SPAS platform provides out-of-the-box Lumen dashboards for all Flink jobs, and each user can plug in their job-specific metrics into the dashboard. Flink job images also include FileView integration, which ships logs from job managers and task managers to our Elasticsearch clusters. Users can use Kibana dashboard to view the aggregated logs and find specific error logs. So what's coming down the road for our Flink platform team? We're going to continue to invest in Apache Flink and the SPAS platform to increase leverage for our users. We want to allow users to focus more on their business logic and less on other tasks, such as integrating with the Netflix ecosystem. We also plan to provide higher level abstractions so our users don't have to write as much code as they do today. Some of the new features that we've been working on this year is to finish our autoscaling project for all of our SPAS jobs. We recently productionized autoscaling for our 2,500 Keystone routers, Flink jobs, and we plan on extending the support to custom Flink jobs as well. We will also be improving our bootstrap and backfill strategies, as well as supporting continuous integration and deployments for our Flink jobs. That's all for my lightning talk on our Flink platform. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mark. If you have any questions on Mark's talk, please find him after all the lightning talks are over. Next up, we have Enrico Canzonieri from Yelp, and he's going to talk to us about streaming SQL.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? All right. My name is Enrico. I work in the data streams team at Yelp. Data Stream is the team that builds and maintains the Yelp's data pipeline. We go from maintaining Kafka, the Kafka deployment, schema registry, the Flink deployment, and then the entire connector ecosystem. This presentation, I'm going to give you a brief overview of Yelp's data pipeline architecture, and then I'll give a deep dive into the Stream SQL service that we implement at Yelp. So let's start from what we do at Yelp. We connect people with great local businesses. To do that, we process a very large amount of data. And in the past, we used to do most of our data processing and data transformation in batch. Over the past few years, we've been transitioning to the streaming world. And today, streaming actually powers a variety of Yelp's use cases. We go from notifications to user search, our entire indexing pipeline. It's just basically the way we index documents into Elasticsearch that then they are used for to power the search engine. These are all done in streaming. And some transaction flows, and then also we do machine learning feature engineering on top of streaming. We actually have some features that are built in real time, and also the features that are built off batch jobs. We still pump the data, the result of those features, into our data pipeline so that we can leverage the connector ecosystem to propagate the data either in our data lake or Cassandra or other data stores when we need it. And then finally ads, and also product development with the experimentation pipeline and the guardrail metrics are built off streaming data. Initially, most of our stream processing was done on Kafka, using Kafka consumers and producers. And then when we started facing scalability issues, that's when we decided to adopt Flink. So we started running Flink in 2017. And the goal for us was to perform a stateful stream processing at a much larger scale than we could do with the native Kafka consumer. And Flink came with some interesting features. For example, event time processing, it was something we couldn't do before Flink. And then in general, like a very powerful and rich streaming API. And on top of that API, we started building what we call reusable components or building blocks. Here are some examples. So we have the entire connector ecosystem. We built the Stream SQL service. A component called Joinery that is used to do unwindowed streaming joins, a component called Aggregator for unwindowed streaming aggregations, and the Sessionizer to sessionize arbitrary logs. We call these reusable building blocks because users can usually activate any of these components by just using a config file or a command line tool. If we look at how all these components fit into the overall Yelp's architecture, in our stack we have on the right-hand side, we have all of our data sources. It can be MySQL, Cassandra, or even Spark Batch. And then the result goes into, or the messages go into this central place where we do all of the processing. And all of our data processing is usually from Kafka, and the result is produced back into Kafka. And then we have data syncs that allow us to distribute the data in all of the data stores that we want to. And then sort of controlling this entire architecture, we have our schema registry that is actually kind of more powerful than just a simple Avro schema registry. It kind of controls all the lineage across the data that we transform and also the connections with our connectors. So let's go back to SQL and see why it is important for us. I think if you look at the industry trend today, you look at all of the data transformation frameworks that are available, you have Spark, Kafka Streams, Apache Beams, Flink, all of them are providing some sort of SQL interface for data processing. And in my opinion, one of the main advantages is that SQL is just a very popular and familiar language for most developers or data scientists or analysts. And because it's so well known, it can help actually decrease the barrier of entry to stream processing. So if you're moving, migrating from batch processing to streaming, there is a steep learning curve in most cases. I mean, by using a familiar interface, we can try to just lower the barrier of entry. And in general, it definitely increases developer speed. So today, Stream SQL kind of sits at the top of our streaming API layers. At the bottom, we have the Kafka consumer producer that we no longer recommend, and developers today no longer develop applications on top of the Kafka consumer, but it's still used for some infrastructure applications. Then we have the Flink streaming API that is in Java Scala, and we support that. However, this is usually recommended for users that need to do some more complex and high-performance stream processing. What we have released more recently is the Apache Beam Python SDK that is now available to our developers. And Yelp is a Python shop, so that's now one of the powerful APIs that is available to developers. And then on top, we have Stream SQL that is probably the most popular one because it's very lightweight for developers to adopt. And it really comes with very low overhead because they don't actually need to maintain clusters. It's a maintained service, it's a managed service that we provide, and we'll see kind of what the interface is. So how does this work internally in Flink? So the support is based on a Apache Calcite, that is this framework that can be used to build MySQL databases. It comes with a query parser, a query optimizer that Flink relies on to generate the Flink job that maps to a specific SQL query. It supports both batch and streaming. However, at Yelp, we all use the streaming side, so I'm not very familiar on the batch side of Flink SQL. I know in 1.9, I think there is another query optimizer called Blink. This is powerful for the batch side. However, I haven't tried that yet. So the way this works sort of logically in Flink, you have a stream. The stream gets mapped into what's called a dynamic table. On Flink, on top of your dynamic table, is running the query and generates another dynamic table. And then you can take the dynamic table and convert back into a stream. So this is kind of the abstraction. The nice thing in Flink is that you can mix and match kind of the data stream API with the table API, that is an API that sits on top of the data stream API, and then finally the SQL API that is the highest abstraction that you have available. So to access SQL, to be able to use SQL in Flink, you need to go through the table API. And there is this component called table environment, which is where you actually register your sources to be table in to be seen by Flink as tables. Your data type that is flowing through the stream has to be of type row, and that's the type that Flink knows how to convert and kind of manipulate internally when running your query. This component, table environment, can also be used to register UDFs that then can be invoked in your query. So now Flink actually supports some native support for protocols, including Avro. So if you have a schematized data that is schematized in Avro, you can probably just plug that into the table environment, and Flink should be able to just kind of detect the schema, convert the schema into the proper table schema, and it should sort of work out of the box. However, if you have some more complex data types, what you may need to do is to build a custom table source. That's what we had to do at Yelp. And honestly, creating a custom table source is not that complicated. You have a class that you need to extend. There are a few methods that you need to implement. These are kind of the main ones. Basically, you need to tell Flink how to extract event time. It's called here row time and processing time. And then how to get the data stream. Is basically the where the data will be coming from. And then you need to give Flink what is the actual table schema to use. If you think about the table schema, it's just the list of column names and list of column types. So if you're what you're trying to convert is an Avro, you basically go through your Avro schema, convert field by field, go from the Avro type to the Flink type, and that's how you convert from an Avro schema into a table schema, and then you just need to register the table schema. You need to do the same thing with the actual data that is going through the data stream. If you have your own type, let's say an Avro record, you need to convert that Avro record into a Flink row. And then after executing the query, Flink will give you back another row. And if so, you want to go back to an Avro, then you need to handle the conversion yourself. So the interface that we give our developers is right now a YAML file. users can specify their input streams. It's more than one because users may want to do some join, their query, and then the output stream. In the Stream SQL service, we write all of the output always into Kafka. So all the output go back into our Kafka clusters. There are some other things that users can configure. For example, max parallelism, whether they want to run their query in event time or processing time, and then finally, what columns they want to use in the output as event time. We have comma line tools that are used to allow users to iterate and develop their queries, so they can do dry runs. They can generate the output of their query and then register the output. And they can also add UDFs using Java. We also recently developed an acceptance testing framework for queries. This is implemented in Python. So the Python part takes care of, through Docker Compose, takes care of setting up the entire testing environment. We'll set up our schema registry, Kafka, and the Flink cluster. And then it will actually, the way developers use the testing framework is by extending a class where they give us the name of their query, the input messages that they want to process through the query, and then what they get back are the output messages. And then it's up to the developers to implement the proper validation for the output messages. Finally, this is our current adoption. We have been using Stream SQL for almost 1 year and a half. Right now, we have over 50 production queries. We haven't actually encountered an issue in terms of performance. The largest query runs about 140,000 messages a second. So at least for our scale, we haven't had any problem. Most of the use cases are machine learning and feature engineering, where we build features transforming streams through Stream SQL. We have some use cases where we do event deduping. So we have, for example, short windows, and we try to dedupe events over the short windows. And then a lot of use cases are about data preparation before a data sync. So for example, filtering data, or projecting specific columns. So this is our these are our engineering contacts. And thanks for listening.
Thanks, Enrico. That was a great talk. Hey, everyone. My name is Shreya, and I work on the product data engineering team here at Netflix. My team is responsible for building and maintaining all the data sets that are generated by our Netflix product. These data sets are then subsequently used for both our homepage personalization and to build the various analytical products and tools that power business insights. So the first use case that I'm going to talk about, how we leverage Flink to kind of power these data sets, is sort of the genesis of all the Netflix product data that flows through our systems. We refer to it internally as consolidated logging. This is the Netflix homepage that I hope most of you are familiar with. Everything we see on this homepage is an event or a user activity that we are logging and sending back to our Netflix servers. We have various kind of what we call our event types. These are buckets of user activity that happen on the Netflix product. These are happening across thousands of devices with different OS and different versions running out there. And they're generating billions of events every day. This is a basic diagram on how this framework is working. All our Netflix applications are sending data to this giant central streaming application on top of Flink, which is consuming all these events, transforming them, enriching them, applying schema on them, and then sending it forward to another Flink application that's going to reroute these data, this data that it consumes, on the various things that people want to consume it downstream. This data is pretty much like our source of truth for all our device data that's that the user activity is being tracked in. This data powers what we will refer to as our impression pipeline. This powers our search, our A/B experimentation, and basically all the downstream data processing that we do with client-side data. At peak, we have seen 4 million events per second on this application, and yet the first application that you see here can maintain a latency of less than 3 milliseconds. Like I said, this is the source of truth for a lot of systems downstream and has a very high value of providing clean, schematized, blessed data for everybody else. The app that I want to talk about more in detail is what we call the Event Extractor, which is the app that is queued after the main app that has processed all the data. This app reads all of that main data once and then produces various versions of the output in different syncs. Like Kafka, it produces data directly to Hive, to our new table format, Iceberg, to Elasticsearch. But the best and the most powerful thing about this app that it can do all of these things without users writing custom code. It does all of this through configs in S3, which users can specify using a YAML configuration, specifying the filter expression, the projections they want, the filters they want, and the sync, the kind of sync they want. So a user who wants some subsection of the user data that they're interested, all they need to go is write up this config, put it in, submit a PR on this app, and the data can start flowing in. This has significantly reduced the operational and the development costs for the team and also reduced the friction for downstream users to get their customs data sets. Next use case I want to talk about is event time partitioning that Julia and Mick's team here have worked on. Playback data, again, is one of our most important data sets. It is the data that is produced by a user watching videos and shows on our Netflix service. It consists of us getting all the raw events, applying sessionization logic on them, and then processing them in a Flink pipeline and writing them to Iceberg. My favorite part about this pipeline is that in a world where all late arriving data and processing data after a while when it is pretty late behind the wall clock time, is usually done with Lambda architecture, that you usually have a supplementing batch job that helps write the slate data back into the table. This app is completely streaming. It has no batch component and deals very gracefully with all late arriving data. The way it does is it maintains a dedupe state, which means it's not writing the same data again if it has written it once. Two, it has a dynamic partitioner that it maintains where it collects and maintains late events and then writes them back into the table without creating too many small files into Iceberg, which can be challenging. Here's the basic architecture diagram of this app. Like I said, there's a function that's doing the deduping. The cool part where it's gathering all the late events, making sure that it's not writing a long tail of late events in one file each, kind of combining them into large data-sized files, reducing the number of files, and then writing them into the table. The third use case I want to talk to, both the pipelines that I talked about before were largely stateless apps, which is that they fall into the category where data is flowing in, some sort of transformation or enrichment is happening, even though this one had sort of like a dedupe state, and then data is being written out. But it gets challenging and exciting when we want to maintain large state in our stream processing apps. So now I want to talk about a large stateful app. Why do we want to do streaming for large state apps? There are various reasons why we want to do it. We are mostly motivated by reducing the latency at which we want to consume this data. Bad jobs that can consume, that read billions of events take hours for us to run. This particular job that we were trying to refactor and move over to streaming would take anywhere between 12 to 16 hours on the batch pipeline to run. So our primary motivator, obviously, is to process the data faster, have the output be available sooner, so that it can be used by our downstream models much faster. This obviously ties in all back that if our models are fresher, it improves user experience. Like I said, the batch jobs which run for 12 to 16 hours, it's not like they're running cheap. They take massive compute resources and can run up to anywhere between hundreds of thousands of dollars. With a streaming job, you don't have to wait for the entire data to be ready for you to start consuming it and then process the output data. If you have raw data that's really large and is consuming a lot of storage space, you don't have to wait for it to collect. You can collect the raw data, summarize it, aggregate it, hold the aggregated and the summarized state, and throw the raw data away. This obviously also allows us to audit real-time audit key metrics. This has really helped us in the past monitor some anomalous behavior on the website. Are we seeing dropped user activity from certain sections of the homepage? Are we not seeing enough plays where we thought we should be seeing plays? So this has really helped us in that area. And also for some basic early detection on any of our engineering systems that did someone push a bug? Was there a schema that was not adhered to? Did we miss something that we should have been getting? So those are all the big motivations where we moved a large join to streaming ETL. This is our basic data flow architecture. We have our Kafka streams going through, which were earlier writing to bad systems. We have a large state Flink app that's reading these sources, grouping them on the keys that we want to group them by, doing the join, maintaining the state in RocksDB like Flink has native integration to, and then writing the output both to a Kafka topic and to a Hive table so that it can be consumed downstream both by streaming and batch consumers. Now, not all wins come without challenges. So there were various challenges we faced with large stateful apps like this one. The biggest one, obviously, is the scale that we are operating in. This app maintains at peak about 4 terabytes of state per region because we have different apps running in different AWS regions. High parallelism jobs are susceptible to some sort of instability. They are hard. It's unlike stateless jobs, it's hard to just throw machines at the problem and fix it. So there are scalability challenges. There's the universal trade-off between latency and correctness. Users want the data right now, but they also want the most complete data right now. So that's the trade-off one has to make. All streaming systems are at most once. So if the Flink job goes down, recovers from checkpoint, all the data that it had processed before is going to write duplicates. And it's very hard to get around that problem. And obviously, data recovery and restatement is fairly challenging in streaming apps. The last use case that I want to talk about is the generic label generation framework that we have one version of running and are actively working on. This system is used to attribute what we refer to as server-side events. When I say server-side events, what I mean is the Netflix services that are generating the data that will be displayed on the Netflix homepage for the users to consume also have valuable information that they log about what they serve to the user. And a lot of our machine learning models would actually like these two data sources to be reconciled with each other. They want to know what was served and why it was served, and why did the server make a decision that it did to give the treatment to the user. So when we say treatment, it's the homepage we saw in the beginning. It's what everyone's seeing on Netflix. And by intent to treat, we mean what did the server intend to treat to the user. So we want to attribute what users saw to all the decision-making that a server that served the user treatment and reconcile that data together. So then machine learning models can use this label data to train on it. This app has a fair amount of complexity, which makes it pretty challenging. Because we are trying to make it in a more generic, unlike the previous use cases, which are serving one particular use case for each app, we are trying to make this a more generic use case where a client event can be any sort of user activity that one does on Netflix. It can be browsing, it can be playing, it can be adding to my list, it can be searching. We want to build this framework for all sorts of user activities. So accounting for that different business logic that has to kind of follow different user activities is pretty challenging. Again, this is a very large stateful app. At peak, it has about 7 terabytes of state. So like I mentioned again before, all large stateful apps require some amount of fine-tuning and configuring them properly so that they can run stably at peak. This app additionally also has a really high number of sources it reads from. Like I said, because it's sort of gathering all user activities, and they can come from a variety of systems at Netflix. They come from Kafka topics. They also come from Hive tables. So just the complexity in reading all these sources and then sort of reconciling them all together poses its own unique challenges. Because it's reading data that is varying in sizes, it has to make the decision where it stores some data in its own Flink's RockDB state, and it also holds some data in an external state because the size of the payload is simply too big to be held in Flink's state. And it has to manage the TTL and the timing of all this data it stores and gracefully clean it up so that we are not having a state size that's growing forever. Okay, that was some of the use cases that we are solving using our Flink platform. And now we'll have a panel to answer some of the questions that all of you submitted. Thank you. Thank you guys for being here and joining us on our panel. Before I start bombarding you with questions, can you do like a quick one-line intro for each of you?
Yep. Hello, my name is Mike Mintz. I'm an engineer at Stripe on the streaming team, where we maintain the Flink platform for the rest of the company.
Hi, my name is Sharon. I'm a software engineer at Lyft, and I also work on the streaming platform team at Lyft, and we provide a managed service to our users to make it really easy to submit and write streaming jobs.
Hi, I'm Steven. I work on the Flink platform team at Netflix.
I'm Julia. I don't work on a Flink platform team. I work on the personalization data engineering team at Netflix.
Hey, can we give a round of applause for all our panelists for answering all our questions? Okay, so my first question is directed a little bit more towards Julia and Sharon, who sort of write applications on top of the underlying infrastructure. When you have a problem and when you have a use case, when do you decide when to go streaming? Like, how do you decide this is a problem that is the right problem for streaming ETL?
So I can give some examples. So
when does it work and not work?
Yeah. So some of the checklist items we look at when evaluating a problem is, one is how important data freshness is, and you kind of touched upon that in your previous presentation. And some use cases are, for example, fraud use cases, where it's imperative to know about fraudulent activity as soon as it happens and to take action in real time. So for example, if a user is like constantly entering credit cards within the last 1 minute they entered like 100 credit cards, that definitely fraudulent behavior, and we want to catch these kind of things in the act. The other situations is like kind of like event-driven programming. For example, we want to take an action when certain event happens. So maybe that can mean keeping a state fresh, taking an action based on that. So wherever use cases where fresh data and real-time insights into data is important. It doesn't work in all cases. In some cases, for example, in some analytics, having real-time data may not be as valuable, or even if real-time information is desired, the results may not be accessed as often. For example, experiment analysis. Experiment analysis are not often conducted continuously. They are probably analyzed one-off. And also in like one-off situations where you want to just generate result once. So in those situations, probably you would choose batch.
I think I agree with all of that. Just to build on that, I think like all things, it's a trade-off between business value and complexity. So, you know, on the business value side, you get the super low latency. You can do some processing that maybe you wouldn't be able to do in batch. You know, like you get better scale lots of times because you're processing events as they go. But on the complexity side, you know, failure recovery, especially when you're doing streaming ETL, which is a case where you usually need much higher accuracy than other streaming applications, is just really hard. Another trade-off is, you know, you have to run and always up systems. And there's also like the challenge of getting this to scale and just operating it in an ongoing basis. And so I think it's about that trade-off. At Netflix, we've gotten pretty good at the reading a stream, doing enrichment, maybe doing some stateless processing. And we can usually build those really quickly, and we can do them at scale, and they're pretty cheap to operate, but they add huge business value. And so that's a case where we really like to lean into streaming. On the other hand, when you try to do something like some of the applications Shreya talked about, where you're doing a two-stream join, or you have a large state and you're doing sessionization, those are a little bit more costly, both to build and maintain. And we have some use cases where we've seen really big value of getting that super low latency signal, and in those cases, it's worth it. But having seen the cost of those, which is very real firsthand, we definitely want to make sure that there is that business value when you're doing that trade-off.
Perfect sense. You touched on data recovery, which I know is only our favorite topic to talk about. So what do we do? Like data recovery, failure recovery. I would say data recovery more so than failure recovery. And there's a nuance in that difference is that unlike batch where data, the input data is at rest and can just be the state of the world remains the same. Streaming, if your app was down, the state of the world has changed, data may not be there. How do we address data recovery and restatement? I'll ask maybe Julia and Sharon to touch upon it, and then Mike and Steven to come, you know, give us some more platform perspective on what platform can do.
So there are like two things, I guess, two parts to your question. One is like failure recovery and data recovery itself. There are many, like in any distributed systems world, even in a Flink application, downtimes happen. We want to figure out how to recover from it. Flink itself provides like some really great ways to manage that. Like we have high availability setup through Zookeeper. We leverage externalized checkpoints quite extensively so that even if the job completely goes down, you can always spin up a new version of the job with the externalized checkpoint. Then the second part is kind of like data recovery, where events may, like the event pipeline may be down and there are backfills that happen. In a streaming world where like old data is, or late arriving data is kind of thrown away, what do you do in these kind of situations when backfills happen? So for us, like we kind of tackle it depending on the use case. In some use cases, we just don't really care if old data comes in, and we just care about what is the latest. But sometimes we would replay the data, like rebootstrap our job, and basically run our streaming jobs to take that old data into consideration for eventual completeness. And obviously having idempotent syncs that can handle like these double writes, one coming from your job that is working on fresh data, and the job that is kind of like backfilling the data that comes back, idempotent syncs are kind of important. So yeah, these are some of the ways we have tackled. And then there is also during deployments, like what happens, how do you deal with like recovery and like smooth deployments when downtimes are handled and so on. So yeah, the high availability setup and the ability to roll back when save point incompatible changes are applied, all those are like invaluable.
Yeah, I'll expand on two things that we are thinking about. So at Netflix, our retention for Kafka class is typically pretty short, like 4 hours, that's default. Sometimes we extend that retention to 24 hours, but overall it's pretty short. That means that you will have to resolve the issue or recover the data before the data expires from Kafka. That put a lot of pressure on everyone. Most of our data in Kafka also land in our data warehouse, where we can keep the data for much longer period. For example, maybe a few months even. And also data warehouse, because they store the data as a Parquet format in S3. So Parquet, the column-oriented compression usually much better. From our experience, for most of the data, they're probably 5 to 6 times better than the Kafka compression. So it's also very efficient for us to store the data in data warehouse for much longer period. So to backfill data that Sri are talking about, we're thinking about building a isolated source in Flink so that the Flink job can consume the data from the data warehouse. For people who are not familiar with Iceberg, it is a table format that is initiated by Netflix. It's designed to solve some of the limitations of a Hive table format, especially running on cloud environment. So our backfill strategy is centered around this, be able to launch, let's say, Flink backfill job and consume from this Iceberg table. Let's say we have the outage, let's say, during Saturday, and come on Monday, we're going to launch a Flink backfill job, read from the Hive Iceberg data table, and then just backfill the data. The other challenge we have is Kafka source give you certain ordering on the data, right? So ordering may not matter for many stateful application, but for many stateful application, ordering doesn't matter because a lot of our stateful application, for example, Shreya mentioned, they use event time. So ordering doesn't matter, and it affects the watermark. So if we're going to backfill from Iceberg source, we need to be able to simulate similar kind of ordering behavior. But based on our discussion with our users, they don't really need the exact strict ordering in Kafka, let's say strict ordering within Kafka partition. They don't really need that because those Flink applications, they typically consume for non-key topic in Kafka. That's one reason. And second, they do the key by within their Flink job. So the strict ordering within Kafka partition, that usually is not required. So in the Iceberg source, we are thinking about building is if we can guarantee some rough ordering, for example, the Iceberg source only emits events, let's say not different within a boundary of 15 minutes or 20 minutes, those kind of ordering typically is good enough for the application. Yeah. So those are the things we're thinking about how can we provide a backfill solution for our users. There's a gap there today, and we're trying to start filling that gap.
Mike, I know you have done some work at Stripe for bootstrapping and backfilling your applications. Like, how are you? How do you think about, like, from a platform perspective, what do you think about when you offer data recovery as a solution?
I have an answer more on the lines of the failure recovery. Okay. I haven't thought too much about data recovery here.
Okay.
But when it comes to failure recovery, there's several different types of failures that Flink is pretty good at automatically being resilient to coming back to. But there are some types of failures that are harder to deal with, and it's good to have a proactive solution rather than a reactive solution and design your application so that these types of failures are less likely to happen. One really, really bad type of failure mode can be corrupt data, like if you have packets that are just invalid bit flips and everything, that can get into your state and your syncs and be really bad. And what we do at Stripe is we try to enable TLS encryption on all of our different links so that if you have packet loss and packet corruption, that just ends up being a slow network as opposed to invalid data. Another really bad type of failure mode can be dealing with malformed input messages. Sometimes you don't have control over your upstream. And if you get some sort of poison pill message, this might mean that your app is just constantly restarting. And this isn't something that you can just fix by deploying onto a new cluster. You have to go into your code and fix it. So we try to make sure that our streaming applications have some sort of dead letter queue functionality, which means that with the flip of a button, we can make sure that all unparsable or unprocessable input messages get republished into a special Kafka topic. And then our application is still able to make progress to buy us some time while we figure out what the actual problem was. And then another really tricky type of failure mode is unanticipated scaling bottlenecks. That's the kind of thing that's usually not caused by a user, so it's harder to track down. It just might be a ticking time bomb. One thing that we really try to do is never run on the largest hardware instance type, so that if you do run out of disk space or run out of memory, you can always just double the size of your instance type. Yay, cloud computing. So those are some ways you can be sort of proactive and avoid the failures in the first place.
Agree. Julia, you want to say something?
I guess one thing I'll say is, from an application perspective, is a little bit of honesty here that we're not very good at failure recovery, especially when we think about streaming ETL. So an example of some of our failure recovery modes involve a combination of playing a Hive source through our stream processing application, running an offline batch job to like clean up the mess that we've made, and then to have some bootstrapping period in our streaming application. And so I think that this is a really big challenge. And often when I'm deciding to go streaming or not, it's do I have the time and resources to figure out, you know, failure recovery for this application or not? And that's often my deciding factor. So I think I'm really excited that so many people are thinking about this problem, and I think especially for streaming ETL, once we crack it, we'll be in a really great place.
Okay, my last question for all the platform folks is, there's such a hot debate between what kind of levels of platform you expose the users to. There's this sort of self-serve that I know we at Netflix are on the spectrum between the self-serve to manage spectrum. We are sort of more on the self-serve side. Users like us are sort of the primary, hold the primary responsibility for our, the operational responsibility of our apps. There is the other end of the spectrum where companies or platform teams will allow users to submit SQL, and the users are kind of, that's all they have to do, and it's the operations and the availability of the job is managed by the platform. So what, how do you think about that spectrum? Where do you try to land? What are sort of the decision-making factors? Mike, I'll start with you.
So this is a hot debate at Stripe within our team, but I would say that today we take sort of a hybrid approach, leaning more towards self-serve when it comes to low layers of abstraction where users have, you know, really arbitrary requirements. But we have several different internal managed platforms at Stripe that are domain specific. So when a user comes to us with a use case that works on one of these platforms, maybe they just have a source and a sink and a simple transformation that happens to fit something that we've already built as a managed platform, we try to push those users onto those platforms so that they don't have to deal with too much complexity. But if their use case doesn't fit any of these platforms, they can always just drop down a layer of abstraction and sort of self-serve onto Flink. But I'm in favor of a future in which we can have all of these managed platforms running on top of Flink, all of the managed platform infrastructure sort of just becoming libraries that any Flink application can use, and then we would be in this really cool, powerful world where anyone can write a Flink app or a Flink SQL query, and us on the platform team, we'd be able to provide different SLAs to different apps depending on which features they're using. But we are a long ways away from there.
Yeah, so at Lyft also we kind of have a hybrid approach. We have so the streaming team itself is like divided into two parts. One is the framework team, which provides the managed solution, and we allow users to submit their jobs by just writing like a config file with a in a declarative fashion and just through the use of Flink SQL. Then we also provide a platform and a Flink platform. And the platform, the goal of the platform is to standardize certain aspects of running a Flink job. So standardizing the metrics, the log collection, and other like high availability setup and things like that. And honestly, even though I would really like for us to get to a truly self-serve way to abstract away as many complexities of running a Flink or a streaming application as possible, but there are certain challenges to that that we have been dealing with for a while. So one of the biggest challenges, in my opinion, is to provide a general reliability guarantees across the managed solution. Because each program, each use case is different. How do you provide a general guarantee? What should be the latency? How much of that latency is attributed to the platform? How much of it is attributed to the user? Things like that. So these are like intricate things to think about.
I have a follow-up question. When you said like you allow users to sort of submit these jobs through declarative, maybe a DSL, are you kind of white gating what they submit? Or are you sort of like safeguarding against, how do you stop someone from submitting group by constar?
Right, yeah, so that's a good question. So right now, as our team is growing and as we are growing the platform, we kind of, it's all done through a review process. So the users write these this declarative code and they tag our team on the PRs and then we review it and then we look for any of these issues that can happen. But to get to a truly general availability, generally available solution, this is a very tricky thing to safeguard against. Like, yeah, how do we stop people from doing crazy things with the app and who will be woken up in the middle of the night when things go down, right? So the on-call and monitoring aspect is really challenging.
Steven, Alec, do you take the last one?
Sure. I think Netflix, we started our Flink usage in our Keystone data pipeline. I think as Mark mentioned, we have like more than 2,000 of those logging jobs. So those are probably some of the most simplest Flink applications, basically just source, sync, just doing log job. So we manage all those for our users, and our users love it because they can just go to our UI, drag and drop. But the downside is not flexible. Let's say if you want to transform data a little bit, our platform UI doesn't support it. We don't support UDF. After the keys from router, the other thing we provide is a low-level Flink as a service. Basically, a user needs to work with the Flink low-level API directly. The reason we provide that first because some of our initial users on Flink, they're actually some of the most challenging use case. They have pretty complex business logic, like SQL or those table API properties are not good enough for them. So that's why we first provide this like a low-level platform. But also, even in the future, if we want to provide them like an abstraction, like SQL, this low-level platform has to be very stable and very have to be great. So we are trying to build a good foundation first. And we have a small team, but in the future, we probably expand to SQL abstraction, but it's not there today. But something definitely in our roadmap.
Thank you guys again for answering all our questions. Since we are out of time, unfortunately, I won't take live questions, but find these guys outside and ask all your questions. Thank you. I want to tell you guys, Flink folks sent us this promo code for Flink Forward in San Francisco that's happening in March. So everyone can use this code and get themselves a discount at Flink Forward.